Les Sylphides. Classic of ballets. Many thousand times performed all over the world. Today, in Australia. It brings back to my memory the day when I arrived in Australia from overseas, a year or two before the war, after a journey with one of those international ballet companies on board, now bound for an Australian season. A delightful cargo. Famous ballet companies had visited Australia before. They'd toured the country with great success, played before packed houses in the big theatres of the great cities. Ballet was such a rare sight here. The great Pavlova had come. She had graced the Australian stage with her dancing, and many a young Australian dancer, deeply impressed, was asking, could there ever be an Australian ballet? The Russian ballet had come. Colonel de Basle and his company were visitors here. Brilliant dancing, colourful shows, great names. Kirsova, Baranova, Ryabushinskaya, Tumanova, Dolin, Lishin. Midnight shows were staged, sold out weeks ahead, 22 and 9 for a seat in no black market. But when the touring companies left, they seemed to take the whole spirit of ballet with them. I had forgotten all about ballet until one afternoon in the Botanical Gardens, I came face to face with Australian ballet. Very young Australian ballet. A delightful sight. But I didn't seem to make the same impression on the young ballerina. Oh, I'd frightened away the shy little Sylphide into the arms of her mother. When I'd approached the little group, I learned from her mother that her daughter was having ballet lessons as part of her education. She said there were many ballet schools of high standard in Australia. Would I like to see for myself one day? Why, certainly.
Boy, play. Boy, play. Boy, play.
It all starts with the five positions of the feet, with footwork at the bar, used to steady the body during the exercise. Bar work is hard with its many routines, and pupils must work many hours a day if they want to make ballet their career.
Two, three, four, one, two, stretch and close. Take place in the centre.
And then there is centre work, a hard task to control the body in free movements. Dancing on points is the essence of classical ballet. Point work remains the main topic in most ballet classes. Advanced pupils and juniors must acquire perfect technique. Rhythm must be precise. Grown-ups will have a quick glance at the youngsters during a spell. Bourrée on points. Not bad. And teenagers will giggle, but it doesn't prove that they could have done better. In keeping with the tradition of international schools, ballet is being taught to children at an early age. Ballet dancing has a deep effect on the souls of children, developing their natural grace, which will become part of their lives and thoughts, and will influence the cultural progress of a nation. And some start very young. This one in front will just the same become one day a new Pavlova from Australia. But the work of a real ballet dancer does not end with pirouette and arabesque, adagio and attitude, entrechat and fouetté. Ballet comprises all forms of art. It requires knowledge of the history and theory of ballet and a wide education as well. It was Pavlova who once said, "Dance with your head." And so they studied for the great chance to win a scholarship offered each year by the Royal Academy of Dancing, London, to find a place in a classical ballet company overseas. Ballet production in Australia did not exist. There was no outlet for their talent. And so they worked for the day of examination, when they had to prove their skill in a dance of their own creation. From the wind on the cliffs, from the glittering sea, from the slowly swaying glide of the seagulls, came inspiration. Scholarship won, another young Australian dancer is on her way to London to complete her studies. It's farewell now to the girls from the class, goodbye to the family.
I shall miss you all. I'm crying a bit. But when I come back, I will be a great ballerina, I hope.
But the young lovers of ballet art didn't give up hope for an Australian ballet. They continued their training whenever they found time. Shop assistants and typists, telephone operators and factory girls rallied together in amateur clubs. They met in church halls and city rooms. In vacant lofts converted from some long-forgotten coach house. It's amazing how many girls in Australia have at one time or another taken up ballet for personal or artistic reasons. Touring companies had created the desire for ballet. In their absence, the little clubs kept ballet alive. It was a movement based on the love for music and dance inborn in the soul of the Australian people. Amateur clubs became the stronghold of Australian ballet art. Here they discussed and worked out ballet, listened to the immortal melodies of the great masters and composers of ballet music. Here they tried their first steps from their own ideas. Here they used their ingenuity in designing and painting their own scenery on old tent canvas, rigged up with makeshift equipment, cheap brushes and paint. It was makeshift all the way. In church halls, seats were used as bar. Some scratchy old record had often to do, since they couldn't afford a pianist. Soon they prepared little shows for which they made their own costumes. Mother gave a hand too, and all scraps from her work bag came in handy. It was all very exciting, and the girls had lots of fun and plenty to talk about. They hadn't seen each other since last night. At shows, dancers proved their great versatility, but the items remained efforts of soloists. Often it was a family affair. Even Cook was there, and I was there too. Yes, I met them all. Mothers.
How do you do?
Aunts.
How do you do?
And friends.
How do you do?
How do you do? How do you do? How do you do? Bumblebee. Ah, the fire dance. Creative or expressive dancing soon captured the imagination of the public. The beauty of nature found its expression in rhythmical dances like the Dance of the Water Lilies, staged against the background of Australian scenery. The chance for ballet in Australia came in those troublesome years before the war when principals from touring companies settled in Australia. Here were leaders with experience, Edouard Borovansky in Melbourne, Elaine Kirsova in Sydney. And here were the enthusiastic followers who flocked to the newly opened schools of Russian ballet. Staging ballet was now the goal. For the first time, the technique of group dancing was developed, the basis of all ballet production. There were many obstacles at first. Ballet production is expensive. It needs months of preparation, facilities for rehearsals. The ballet clubs and wealthy supporters of ballet came to the rescue. Funds were raised by subscription and donations. The Melbourne Ballet Club even built a stage in a studio. Here the first training took place. The first small shows were staged. Within 2 years, by 1940, Edouard Borovansky and Elaine Kirsova both had fully trained companies ready for public performance. Hard work was bearing fruit. Ideals became reality. But there were 1,000 more heartbreaks and worries before the great event came, the opening night. Ballet is a dramatic art. The stage is its medium. Experts were required. Arthur Fleischmann worked on a model stage. Loudon St. Hill, designer of many ballets, cut and matched figurines to his stage scenery. Checking drawings with the color of the actual material. draping cloth around dummies to test the effect of its final shape. Choreography came into its own, the art that creates the design and pattern of movements. Sometimes worked out on paper with dots and arrows and lines indicating the dancers' positions, bodies moving into circles, circles dissolving into lines, lines forming into groups. Laurel Martin and Dorothy Stevenson, the Australian ballerinas, became successful choreographers. Classical ballet has few written records. The traditional routines to be followed are passed on from dancer to dancer. Ballet expresses all human emotions, expresses the tenderness of the soul, the strength of the body and mind. Ballet is music transformed into vision, story unfolded in rhythm of movements, poetry without words, drama without speech, opera without song. Choreography has mastered it all. N Saga was one of the first ballets presented by Edouard Borovansky in the Melbourne Ballet Club. Men and women working in peace, drum beats of war heard. Men take up the challenge with staccato beats of their feet, while women kneel and unavailingly pray for peace. It was an appreciative audience that attended the show. Even Les Sylphides, Fokine's masterpiece, was staged, with its strong demands on the dancer's technique. A big test even for a professional company. A daring attempt by a newly formed group of ballet dancers. Test was successful. Here was ballet staged and performed by Australians. But the seasons did not last long. One night, two nights, eventually five nights. Performances were sporadic with long intervals in between. After 2 years, a full week season was staged. Gradually, a wider public took an interest in ballet. People had to queue up for tickets, and I too had to take my place in a queue. At the same time, Madame Kirseva presented ballets of technical perfection with dancers trained in her School of Russian Ballet in Sydney. Audiences were delighted. Ballet performances became social events, and the press everywhere gave ballet their fullest support. But ballet could not support its members. It was not a profession. Ballet did not pay. Too long were the intervals between seasons, and seasons were too short. Sylphides had to go back to work to make a living. But the girls were not dismayed. They had something to believe in now, and they intensified their efforts. They worked in the daytime, trained at night. But when they returned to work, their minds were still on ballet. Meanwhile, the little ballet groups kept ballet going. They remained the pioneers of Australian ballet art. Small ballets were soon produced with Australian music and choreographers. Subjects of a wide range were approached. Medieval France provided the background for a gay ballet, Conte Heraldique, or The Witch's Whim, danced by the Ballet Guild. A strong contrast to classical ballets was provided by schools of rhythmical dancing like that of Madame Bodenwieser. They were regarded by many as a welcome addition to ballet and as a source of comparison and new ideas. Demon machine, the problem of man as part of our machine age. And the Blue Danube, masterpiece of European art, which also found a haven in Australia when steps of a different kind, the steps of a brutal force, rocked the foundations of Europe. Repeated efforts of the ballet groups, their continuous success with a public craving for ballet shows, eventually induced the professional theatre to follow suit. From now on, the stage door was open to the Australian ballet, never to be closed again. The strict rules and exacting routine of professional ballet, with shows and rehearsals, rehearsals and shows, soon absorbed completely the life of the ballet dancers. And there was always the maestro to cope with. ballet dancing was now a career. It was recognized as a profession. Few reaped the fruits of the efforts of many. Their names appeared on the payroll. And after pay, there is no better place than home. Or is there? Yes, ballet shoes come first. They are always a worry. The making of ballet shoes is a special art. It needs skillful hands to cut the heavy satin to pattern, to prepare the lining for every shoe. Satin is a delicate material. It soon shows signs of wear. Tips of shoes have to be mended continually. A leading dancer may wear out two new pairs during one night's performance. Hundreds of pairs are needed by the corps de ballet during a season. Quite an expense. Each pair costs over £1. The cut material is now stitched together, ready for the soles. Soles are cut from fine, pliable wood. They must be strong, yet elastic, must give support to the feet in their strenuous positions, but must bend to a certain degree. Ballet dancers personally select the right kind. Too weak a sole may cause a sprained ankle. One too rigid may tire out the feet. The square front of the ballet shoe is then strengthened with special lining. Layer upon layer is molded on, even and tightly, without a fold, until the tip of the shoe is strong, like leather. Another pair ready, another customer satisfied. And then the dressmaker. One ballet frock has sometimes 8 layers, 5 yards for each skirt. It requires 30 yards of material to dress a sylphide, and each dress has to be made to measure, must fit at the dress rehearsal. And then the show. Ah, backstage again. The dressing rooms of the corps de ballet, where skillful hands make up the face of classical ballet. Mask-like, with heavy lines, hard but impressive. And there always seems to be too little time to change from reality into the world of make-believe. Swan Lake Ballet. Now the stage manager calls for the swans. A last glance into the mirror. In 5 minutes the curtain will rise. Backstage of ballet. Atmosphere of ballet all over the world. Of Covent Garden, Sadler's Wells, London. Of Paris, L'Opéra Comique. Flurrying skirts and fleeting feet. Hurry, hurry, soon the curtain will rise. Swans and Swan Princess, Prince and Huntsman. Swan Lake Ballet to Tchaikovsky's immortal music. Romantic tale of a princess and her companions bewitched by an evil spirit into swans. Swans that are allowed to take human shape from dusk to dawn. The prince falls in love with a swan princess. From dusk to dawn, his love will last. The swans have gone at daybreak. A last hitch. Hurry! In 3 minutes the curtain will rise. The hunters arrive. Backstage of ballet, with the nervous heartbeat of the novice, the posed calm of old troopers. Now the stage is set. Lights, stage and footlights. In 1 minute the overture will start. It seems like ages. Their work done, the stagehands take it easy. Stand by, orchestra. Music. Stand by, spotlights and curtain. Curtain up. Get ready, dome. Full spotlight. Spotlight on Australian Ballet. Thank you. interval, the applause has died down. No more curtains. Stagehands and prop men work feverishly. The Swan Princess returns to the dressing room of the ballerinas. Hello. Yes, it's a good house today. 6 curtains. But look, another pair of shoes gone. Oh. There goes the call for the next ballet. On stage, fishermen and peasant girls, washerwomen and gay ladies. Ballet of life in a Mediterranean village. Capriccio Italien. Followed ballet. Program followed program. Soon the whole machinery of the stage worked smoothly for ballet production. The watchful eyes of the head technicians, quiet and observant, saw to it. Electricians, scene shifters, prop men and stagehands worked with all their skill to split-second timing. The crowded theatres and long seasons were full recognition of Edouard Borovansky and of the fine work he had done for the professional ballet in Australia. But only in front of the footlights, amongst his brilliant ballerinas, his tightly disciplined corps de ballet, his soloists, did he find his ambition fulfilled, to be part of the ballet he had formed. In his dressing room, he makes up a strong man for his part in the ballet Beau Danube. Last, ballet was firmly established on the stage in Australia, with regular seasons a matter of form. And as art had inspired ballet, ballet inspired art. Famous artists devoted their skill to its delicate subject and its power of expression. Ballet is one of the most refined media of artistic expression, and the cultural standard of nations can well be judged by their efforts to develop ballet into a national art and make it one of the art treasures of the people. Now ballet took a serious place in Australia's artistic life. It became a study, and the public began to see ballet through new eyes. So did I. How charming. Sketches, drawings and paintings by Australian artists found their way into homes and museums all over the world. So, with the growth of ballet in Australia, the Australian ballet was born. Australians had mastered the technique of ballet production, stories that became music, rhythm expressed in painting, paintings transformed into life, stage, ballet. So far, Australians had only presented the stories of other nations, ballets from all over the world. Now their aim was to create their own ballets, master the art to present Australia to the world. Now they focused their attention on their own problems, looked to their own land for inspiration, and found it in the little-known past, in the dramatic story of their own landscape, the lore of the Aborigines. Australia had never developed its own national dances, telling the tales of the nation with music and rhythm. There was no link between past and present. Today, this link exists. In the work of John Antill, Australian composer, the rhythm and tribal dances of the world's oldest race, the Australian Aborigine, are transformed into modern music, into the ballet Choreography. The Australian pioneers once had planted in an empty land the seeds that made Australia grow. So in the hard soil of a young country's bare fields of art, the artists worked. So grew the score, so grew Choreography, Australian ballet with Australian story, decor and choreography. Out of the classical ballet grew the Australian ballet. Australian masters of pen and brush, of melody and dance, produced it. Came the story by Tom Rothfield, the white man taking over the spirit of Australia from the Aborigines. Came the melody by Esther Rofe. Came the sketch and the drawing for the decor by William Constable. came the painting of the backdrop. Came the stage and the scenery, came the ballet, Terra Australis. Australia. It has gone a long way in 10 years, a short time. It has taken its place and will hold it among the ballets of the nations. Australian ballet has come to stay. Spotlight on Australian ballet.